May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen.
Amen.
Please be seated. Well, here we are on the first Sunday of Advent, the first day of a new liturgical year. So happy New Year. Advent is a season of hope and expectation and reconfiguration and reorientation. You might be wondering, what is going on? What is happening to our church? If you are, that's good. That's actually kind of the point. If you're feeling somewhat apprehensive or disoriented or bothered or annoyed at the priest, that's okay. Just sit with that emotion. When I studied with the Jesuits in Berkeley, they would often say in response to someone sharing a challenging emotion, why don't you sit with that? I invite you to sit with that emotion. What happens when you sit with that? So I invite you to be compassionate to yourself. Hold those emotions compassionately. We are no longer in ordinary time. We have busted out of ordinary time, which is the longest season in the liturgical year, which makes sense because most days of our lives are ordinary days. Do you know when ordinary time began for us? Does anyone remember? June 4th, Pentecost, 6 months ago. Remember Pentecost when we gathered outside with our beautiful fiery streamers and processed in and celebrated the birthday of the Christian church with cake and balloons and a bounce house? 6 months of ordinary time. Now, a lot of special and extraordinary things happened during that time. We had a wonderful baptism of Ryan. We had our 60th anniversary. We had a memorial service. We had the bishop's visit. But this all took place within ordinary time. And most days, as I said, of our lives are ordinary, which is why the time is so long in the liturgical calendar. But not today. Today is the first Sunday of Advent. Are we ready? Are we awake? That's the question that Jesus has for us in the gospel this morning. Are we ready? Am I ready? Am I ready to worship in this new configuration? I'm actually not entirely sure. I actually had a dream about the first Sunday of Advent here at Redeemer a few nights ago. And I won't go into too many details because it's kind of bizarre like most of my dreams. But I'll share a little bit. The church is crowded. It's very crowded. It's so crowded that we actually have to use my office as an overflow room. And because there's a full adult choir and a full children's choir, the procession takes almost 10 minutes. And I remember in the dream, I'm in the narthex, and the procession has begun, and Carol Ann approaches me about one of the readings, which is so interesting, because you just did that. She approached me about one of the readings, and it was about a whale. The whale of Advent. So it must have been about Jonah. I don't want to try to figure what that means, but I remember talking to her about the readings and about the whale, and I keep talking with her so much that I'm late for joining the procession. The procession has already happened. So I have to run down the nave and quickly reverence the altar. And then I end up sitting in the chancel area where I believe Paula is the lem. And as the readings begin, I realize I don't have a sermon prepared. So I was not really ready for Advent. I did not have anything to say to a church full of people. However, in the dream, oh, and here's the lem of my dreams right now. In the dream, I didn't have anything prepared except I had one poem that I knew I wanted to share. One poem. And that brought me some relief. So I will continue to make my dreams come true, which Caroline has already started to do, as well as Paula, by reading this poem. And it's a poem by a contemporary of St. Francis, whom we learned about last Sunday from our resident Franciscan. So he lived in the 13th century, but he lived in what is now Afghanistan. And he was a Muslim. He was actually a mystic of Islam. Does anybody know who I might be talking about? Sufism is the Islamic mystical branch of Islam. Mm-hmm. I think Rumi said it. Rumi. Jalal ad-Din Rumi. So this was the poem that I was prepared to read in my dream. So I'm going to read it to you. Rumi, actually considered one of the most famous poets in the world, this is translated by Coleman Barks, and the poem is called The Guest House. This being human is a guest house. Every morning a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness. Some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all. Even if they're a crowd of sorrows who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture, still, treat each guest honorably. He may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice, meet them at the door laughing and invite them in. Be grateful for whoever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond. Be grateful for whoever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond. So are we ready? Are we making room for some new delight? Are we ready to welcome a guide from beyond? We might be wondering, why did Father Daniel move out the altar from behind the rail? Why is our Celtic cross covered with an abstract painting? What happened to our Stations of the Cross? And why is the chancel basically empty except for some chairs and some scattered creatures? Good questions. What do you think? Are we being cleared out for some new delight? What does God have in store for Redeemer? Advent is about waiting expectantly for the coming and the arrival of the Christ child, which we all celebrate joyfully at the Christ Mass at Christmas. And Advent is about waiting expectantly for the second coming of Christ. In our gospel reading today, Jesus is not talking about his first coming as a child. He's already grown up. He's talking about his second coming. And he doesn't even know when that will be. But it is coming. And it will probably be uncomfortable. In fact, he says it will be uncomfortable and disorienting. Jesus' words are the conclusion of his long response to a conversation that began when one of his disciples said to him, "Look, Jesus, look at our temple. Look at how beautiful it is. Look at how big it is. Don't you think we have the best temple in the world?" Actually, at the time, they probably did have one of the biggest, most beautiful temples in the world, the Jewish people. And how does Jesus respond? I actually invite you to open up your Bibles and your pews to Mark 13. We actually began a new gospel during this new liturgical year, the Gospel of Mark, the earliest and shortest of the Gospels. Last year, we spent a lot of time with the Gospel of Matthew. I want you to look at Jesus' response in verse 2 of Mark 13. Somebody read that.
Then Jesus asked him, "Do you see those great buildings? Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down."
Not one stone will be left here upon another. All will be thrown down. Wow. Jesus is talking about the temple where the presence of God resides, where daily sacrifices are made, where collective memories have been forged, and where the Jewish pilgrims gather at least three times a year. This is the center of the world for the Jews. It's what religious scholars call the axis mundi, the center of the world. It would be like a Muslim saying that Mecca will be destroyed and razed to the ground. For Jews, the destruction of the temple would mean the end of the world, which is why this chapter in Mark's gospel is called the Apocalypse, or the Apocalyptic Discourse. In fact, the destruction of the temple in the year 70 AD did mean the end of the world for the Jews. We call the Judaism of Jesus' day Second Temple Judaism, because so much of it revolved around and was dependent upon the temple worship. So actually, the Judaism of Jesus' day no longer exists, because there is no temple. In order for something new to arrive, we must make room for it. Christianity and rabbinic Judaism, Judaism of today, are the result of Jewish people reorienting themselves in the aftermath of a profoundly disorienting experience, which was the destruction of their temple. Yesterday, several of us gathered here in the chancel to pray all 150 Psalms. I was doing that with Father Christopher at St. Paul's, and Joan joined us. And all 150 Psalms can be classified into three categories: Psalms of orientation, Psalms of disorientation, and Psalms of reorientation. And our psalm this morning, Psalm 80, is a psalm of disorientation, asking God, how long must we eat and drink our tears? How long must we be derided by our neighbors and scorned by our enemies? Restore us, O God, reorient us, bring us new life and light. In order for something new to arrive, we have to make room for it. We have to be willing to let go of what feels most comfortable. We have to be willing to feel uncomfortable and disoriented and be hospitable to those feelings that might make us profoundly disoriented. We need to do that so that we can welcome what God has in store for us. We need to sit with those emotions. So as we prepare our hearts to welcome the Christ child at the Christ Mass, let us also prepare our hearts for Christ's second coming. Let us be awake and ready for Christ to show up here at Redeemer in ways that we cannot yet even imagine. I want to conclude with a brief story that I heard this week. This last Wednesday, I was honored to be part of a three-person interfaith panel at American River College in Sacramento. So I was representing Church of the Redeemer as well as the entire Christian tradition, which was slightly intimidating. And I was sitting next to a Jewish scholar on my right and an Islamic scholar on my left. And the theme of our discussion was hospitality, specifically the hospitality of Abraham, whom all three traditions honor as a patriarch, as the main patriarch. And both the Jewish and Muslim scholars shared essentially the same story of Abraham. And it's a story that's not in our Bible. It's part of Jewish Midrash, and it's part of the collections of the prophet Muhammad's sayings. And it's the story of Abraham going out to seek his first son, his oldest son. Does anybody know who that is?
Ishmael.
Very good. His oldest son, Ishmael, whom he had with Hagar, whom he was actually forced to expel, because he had a second son, Isaac, that was through his wife, Sarah, and that's where the promise was going to continue, the blessing and divine promise. And Sarah got uncomfortable, so he asked him to expel Hagar and Ishmael. That is in our Bible. But what's not in our Bible is Abraham seeking out Ishmael as he has become an adult, after he has become an adult. And in the story, Abraham finds his son Ishmael's family, but Ishmael is away on a business trip or something. So Abraham asks Ishmael's wife how the family is doing. And Ishmael's wife is not very welcoming or friendly to him. And she responds to his question by complaining about how miserable and difficult their life is in the desert. Abraham then tells Ishmael's wife, When your husband returns, please tell him that I say hello, and tell him to change the threshold of his gate. And when Ishmael returned from his trip, his wife told him that this old and ugly and decrepit man came by with a strange message. Change the threshold of your gate. And Ishmael realized that the man was his father Abraham, and that he was telling him to divorce his wife, which he did. And then several years later, after Ishmael remarried, Abraham returned to visit Ishmael's family, and Ishmael was once again away on a business trip. Abraham spoke with Ishmael's second wife and asked her how the family was doing. And she responded by saying, "We are doing so well. We are overflowing with abundance here in the desert. And you should come into our home and join us for dinner and stay a couple nights." And Abraham said, "Thank you, but I must be on my way. But please tell your husband that I say hello and that he should hold fast to the threshold of his gate." And when Ishmael returned, his wife told him that this wise and dignified man had visited and said, "Hold fast to the threshold of your gate." And Ishmael knew that this meant his father Abraham was telling him to cling tightly to his wife, because she knew how to be grateful and how to be hospitable. Hospitable to a random stranger. Ishmael's second wife was named Rala, and she actually became the great-great-great-grandmother of the Prophet Muhammad. So as we celebrate Eucharist together at the threshold of our altar rail, let us emulate Ishmael's wife, Rala, and practice gratitude and hospitality, and even welcome whatever awkward or disorienting feelings we might have. We will form a half circle around the altar, and I will actually be facing with you the empty chancel, so that we are all praying and facing God together, open and hospitable to whatever is to come. Because in the words of Rumi, this being human is a guest house. Every morning a new arrival, a joy, a depression, a meanness. Some momentary awareness comes as an unexpected visitor. Welcome and entertain them all, even if they are a crowd of sorrows who violently sweep your house empty of its furniture, still treat each guest honorably. He may be clearing you out for some new delight. The dark thought, the shame, the malice, meet them at the door laughing and invite them in. Be grateful for whatever comes, because each has been sent as a guide from beyond. May it be so. Amen.